I remember one time I was giving a graduation speech and I was walking down the aisle with the president. A student jumped up and handed me a note and stopped everything, the parade, the music. And the note simply said, "Blessed are ye that are brief, for you should be reinvited." It's important for me to be brief so I can be reinvited and stay as a part of Phyllis's team. Phyllis, listen to what I'm saying, please. Thank you very much. Now, we all enjoy our leader, Phyllis. She's very special, and now we have another colleague to come aboard, and it's an exciting team. And I want to go back to the origins when I first joined them, leaving the Senate after 30 years up there in the Puzzle Palace. It was a marvelous transition for me into something I was very comfortable in doing, because I told them I didn't want to run anything anymore, that I was a darn good listener, and I'm a pinch hitter. I can get up, like an old senator told me one time, "Hey, Senator, get up, start talking, and eventually you think of something to say." So here I am. But I'm just going to pick on a couple of words that fascinated me up here. And my good friend Admiral McGinn, we were part of Phyllis's team, and we traveled together extensively in the early days. And you mentioned to the group here your concern about the security. And a week ago tonight, last Monday night, I was in a think tank discussion on national security, and it was a meeting of the National Security Council. I'm president. And incidentally, half the participants had actually been Secretary of Defense, Secretary of Homeland Security. They were all there. We all came back. And our hypothetical was, we've just got notification that the Northeast grid has been taken down by cyber. So, Phyllis, I think we've got to begin to expand our parameters, as was mentioned by Secretary Kidd. We've got to think about that. I'm not about to get into the diversity and the complexity of that issue, but it is huge, and it affects your representation of your constituency, each and every one of you in this room, and what America's got to do about that in the future, and particularly as it relates to energy. Because we can do all the magnificent things with the renewables and recyclables and all of the things we got. And bingo, if that grid goes down, we got a problem. So this is a big challenge to the country. The other observation I'd make, Madam Secretary, you talked about sort of momentum and so forth. The one thing I remember so well was when Phyllis put together the team. We traveled to umpteen states and all over the country, speaking to university audiences and everything. At that time, our mission was to free America of its reliance on foreign oil. And that was a message that everyone seemed to be able to grasp and understand. And here we are, the biggest, most powerful country in the world, yet we're so dependent on others for sources of our energy. So let's all get together and charge. And sure enough, the good old Department of Defense, and I'm privileged to have been an alumni of that organization for many years, although you were hardly on planet Earth when I was there. But I spent some time in the good old Navy. This issue kind of reminds me of when you were on the old battle cruisers or even a battleship, and when she was plowing into that storm, there were literally periods when the whole bow disappeared, and then it came back up again, and you got that surge. A question I would put to the audience, when we first started and we had these understandable issues by the public, we had the support of everybody. How do you keep that momentum going today in these programs, which I deem essential? I deem them essential because I don't want us to fall back again on our haunches, no matter how great our supply of natural gas is. The fracking is a magnificent development, it's a multiplier. How do we maintain the momentum to keep going forward with these initiatives that have been built up over the 5 years since we started our programs and not let us succumb to falling back, since we're so powerful today and thinking about exporting our energy to others. So with that simple question, I withdraw from the artist and yield the floor to our new chair here.
Thank you.
All right, let's start with that momentum question. Oh, Denny, you're looking at me, so you get to answer it.
Senator, I think what is going to carry us forward, that momentum, is what I refer to as the business case. If you look at the costs, the benefits, and the risks associated with various forms of energy technology, we are seeing more and more examples of it being a better outcome for a variety of activities across our whole economy and across our whole society, including, of course, in our armed forces, in our Department of Defense. And we're seeing examples in the states, for example, where there have been attempts to roll back renewable portfolio standards or other policies that are intended to bring forward more and more renewable energy, sustainable solutions. And those attempts to roll them back aren't being successful because the business community is saying, wait a second, we are creating new value chains here, real jobs and real benefit to our stockholders, and I think that will keep us going forward, the capitalist momentum, if you will, as well as this idea that people are becoming more and more aware at the local, regional, and global level. This thing about the science of air quality or water quality or global warming is really starting to get some traction, and I think the combination of it's good for our energy security, it's good for our environmental security, it's good for our national and economic security, and I think that will keep the momentum going. We just need to recognize that there are going to be a lot of speed bumps along the way that will be put down by people who are currently extracting a lot of good value from their part of the energy piece, the status quo, if you will. But I think that there's a lot of momentum going forward.
Miranda, maybe, you know, you brought the word up. Maybe you can be specific, too, for us. And, you know, within the Air Force, who is the big energy consumer, how have you kept their interest in these issues? Or do you find that to be a struggle?
Hello, is this one on? Yeah. Well, I would say that we're reigniting some of the momentum. And my answer to your question, sir, is probably going to sound a little boring. So we love in these forums to talk about big, exciting new policies and new goals and leaders talking about things. And those elements are helpful at igniting processes. But maintaining momentum, in my view, requires some pretty boring stuff. It requires setting up organizational structures, staffing. I think both of my counterpart organizations have done a fabulous job with staffing. It requires setting up governance structures that are horizontal, that have regular, repeated reporting up of progress towards goals. And that is really kind of boring, businessy, MBA kind of stuff that we don't really like to talk about in these forums, but in my view is fundamental to maintaining the momentum ignited by inspirational leaders and by goals. Goals are just goals, right? Some people are motivated to meet goals, some people aren't. So goals are good and they're helpful, but you really have to do the boring stuff. To maintain that inertia.
Well, so I mean that requires some balancing, right? Of the mission and of environment and of energy. And you feel like you've got that balance right?
I don't think it's ever exactly right. I think in the Air Force over the last couple of years, when we've looked at energy, we've been a little too focused on meeting goals. And so we haven't had the speed and the momentum that we could have. We are very much refocusing on mission. and helping our warfighters make that link between what's happening with energy and their mission. I would say that we've had a little bit of what I would consider an outdated view on, let's just use facility energy assurance as an example. So if you look at an installation, and this actually happened to me, I was on my way to a very remote base, and I was sitting on the bus with the base commander, and he pulls out this board, because we had about an hour drive, he pulls out this board to talk to me about his installation, his big installation concern. He said, "Ma'am, my big installation concern is energy security." And I said, "No, wait a minute. Did somebody warn you that I was coming?" He said, "No, it really is." And he had a base that had one substation coming in, fairly remote base, and that substation is very close to the fence line. This particular base commander happened to be a cop, so he kind of saw the world through risk. And in his view, he could imagine somebody driving up next to this substation with a bomb in a truck and blowing up the substation and taking out the energy infrastructure. Now, you got to get that the Air Force actually runs our warfighting mission from our bases here in the United States. So we don't just come home to our bases to train and to rest and recuperate. We're actually running our war from here. And if this particular base lost power, a significant portion of real combat missions would be taken down. So he said to me, "So ma'am, I've got two toolkits. On my left hand, I've got technology. Give me some more diesel gen sets, and I'm gonna work with utility to add a second substation. In my right hand, I've got financial tools, so give me some more Milcon." Right, it's a very 20th century approach. Give me Milcon to buy more diesel gen sets to solve my problem. And said, "Well, give me the map." So we looked at the map, and there's incredible solar resource, incredible geothermal opportunity at this particular location, real possibility for battery banking, microgridding. We could really look to 21st century solutions. And then when you look at the right-hand toolkit that has the financial tools in it, well, gosh, we're not going to get Milcon to do this work. We don't have any Milcon, right? John told us we don't have any Milcon, and he's right. So we got to look to the tools that Secretary McGinn laid out. We got to look to PPAs. So this kind of change of mindset, shift in momentum, requires infusion of new ideas intentionally and strategically. I don't know if I'm answering your question.
No, that's perfect. Gone off on a tangent, but. And actually, I want to pick up on it and ask Richard a specific question. But John, I want to put you on notice, because after I asked Richard this question, I would love to hear you talk about cybersecurity and the future and the questions that the senator posed. Richard, what Miranda just said about how you solve these problems, the Army's been very forward-leaning in that. So if we have companies that are here today that heard what she just said and it's music to their ears, how do they actually do it? You know, how you know, it's great to say there's a solar resource and there's a geothermal resource, but how do they actually do business with the Army or the Air Force or the Navy?
So I liked Secretary Ballantyne's comments. So I'm a boring guy with an MBA, and I like doing all that boring stuff about process improvements and enhancements. And what we in the Army have tried to do, and I think you see it in the other services as well, is we've tried to look at third-party finance from the perspective of the private sector. I mean, it's so easy to be the federal government, as Secretary McGinn outlined, and just throw out the RFP and make the industry scramble to answer all the thousands of questions on the RFP, and that is part of the process, and you can't get around it. But we spent a lot of time, particularly in our renewable space and with our energy savings performance contracting, to meet with our industry partners and try to understand their interests and their perspective. Also, because not only is it's third-party finance, so behind our immediate partner, there's a financial community that's interested in the perceptions of risk and credibility and continuity from the federal government. So we've all spent a lot of time at various venues talking to the financial community and letting them understand that we are a reliable partner, and that we are open for business, and that we are a safe bet for their investment dollars through our third-party financing.
Thank you. John, so how about what Senator Warner teed up and the future, and particularly cyber risk and the marriage between cyber and energy? How's the department, how are you looking at that?
So let me do this. I'm going to answer that question and the other question about inertia because
awesome.
I was chomping at the bit to get to that one. Because I think there's a degree to which inertia that we've got going on today is in the right direction, not the wrong direction. When you get the car going up to a certain speed, it's about hitting your brakes, not about, you know, if you let the inertia happen, you're going to keep going forward. I think right now the inertia is going forward. The inertia is we've gotten people used to asking the question, what is the energy performance of this? We're doing energy sustainability analyses for our new procurement programs. We're asking the question. It's not dissimilar from what we do with climate change in the department. I mean, we've essentially said to folks, there's a lot of risk you can mitigate if only you acknowledge it exists. And so if you look at the risk dynamics of energy or climate and you acknowledge those risks exist, then you can think about what you can do to mitigate them and if there are low-cost types of things. Cyber is one of those risks. We have to acknowledge that it exists. It's hard not to acknowledge it exists because there's cyber attacks in the news every day. I certainly know that my records are somewhere else but because of it. So now you look at the cybersecurity policy that's been promulgated in the department in these really boring documents called DoD instructions. There's one that the CIO put out that basically says, you are in charge of your own platform IT. What the hell is platform IT? Platform IT is simply if you build something and you have an electronics component to it, you're in charge of the cybersecurity for that component. If I have a Jeep that I happen to have developed with cybersecurity flaws and somebody can stop my Jeep from their laptop sitting on their couch in their living room, then it's my fault. It's not the CIO's fault. So when we talk about our buildings, if you look around the room, there are these little boxes on the walls that control the temperature and track, and we're all pushing forward with all these energy initiatives to try and incorporate smart this and smart that into our infrastructure. How do we manage the energy and get the next couple percent down? Well, all of those are cybersecurity risks. Now, we have to think through that problem and mitigate that risk because it's not worth making a huge vulnerability, not quantifying it, if just for a couple percent of improvement in performance. So we have to think that through before we put things in place. Cybersecurity, we're starting to look at those industrial control systems, whether it's the energy control, the boxes that make the elevators go or the escalators, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's our responsibility. There are other folks who have to deal with, the various tactical systems in the department, different platforms, whether it's ships or planes or whatever. There people have to worry about those too. Point is that everybody has to pay attention to cybersecurity, and that's not even getting to the grid. That's somebody else's job, frankly. We just have to worry about the fact that somebody might take it down. And that it'll impact our bases, but the fact of the matter is that we've got a lot of problems we have to pay attention to inside the fence line too.
How about the grid, Denny? Is it somebody else's responsibility?
It's all of our responsibility. But one of the trends that we're seeing is this thing called distributed generation, and what that means is the ability to generate the power that you need, or the heat that you need, thermal energy, closer to where you actually use it. And that lends itself to creating microgrids. So you can envision a time, if we do this right, where we have a grid of grids so that the grid, if it goes down, a major portion like the scenario that Senator Warner shared with us about the Northeast, it won't be everything going down a la Superstorm Sandy. It may go down in major portions of geography and society and economic activity will slow down, but it doesn't stop because the more you have distributed generation assets, the better you're going to be able to continue on in a much more resilient way. I'll cite the example of our Navy submarine base, New London, Connecticut. We're putting in 8 megawatts of distributed generation there, combination of gas and diesel and renewables, and a microgrid that will, just as the example that Richard used, not only for Schofield Barracks, will not only power the Naval Submarine Base, but will power the city of Groton in key first responder areas, in medical facilities, as well as in even a commercial corridor so that people can get groceries and gasoline and everything if the next Superstorm Sandy comes along. So It'll take a long while to do it, but it is happening, where we are creating more and more distributed generation through the proliferation of these renewable energy assets. You start bringing in more and more affordable storage capability, and pretty soon you've got a grid of grids that will help against a variety of threats, whether they're so-called kinetic, somebody blowing something up, or mechanical failure, or cybersecurity.
Can I do 15 seconds?
Of course.
And so there's a key word that Denny said and Richard said it earlier, it's resilience. It is not about stopping something from happening. It's about recovering quickly and minimizing the damage. That's what we're going to be having to think about, whether it's the grid going down or something happening in one of our buildings. How can we incorporate and inculcate a mentality of resilience?
Well, can you answer your own question? How are you? I mean, all of you, you all mentioned resilience, right? What is the department doing to do that? You can punt and give it to someone else.
No, I mean, it's
you're just giving me that look.
Somebody else wants to answer the question, but it's more complicated than just what are you doing, right? I mean, it's a different way of thinking about the problem. So
right.
As we look at, we have power resilience on our bases. We have diesel generators across our bases. And yes, it's boring.
It's not boring. Stop saying that. You got a room full of excited people. It's not boring.
And they emit greenhouse gases, and it's not the sexy thing to talk about. But the fact of the matter is that they're there because they work. And so, we hope. And so, you know, look, after Superstorm Sandy, I gathered my staff together and said, we need a new backup power policy. We need to do some stuff with generators. Let's put out new policy saying you have to put these backup powers against all these loads, you have to identify your loads, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And they came back to me and said, wait, all this policy exists. You don't have to create new policy for this. It's already there. And so what we did was we ended up doing an oversight exercise. And we spent 6 months, and we went to all the services, and we said, all right, come back and tell us whether you've got your critical loads identified, whether you've got backup power on those loads, whether you test that backup power, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And what we found was we're actually doing a pretty good job on that. There were some testing things that we fell short on. We're working to rectify that. And now we're doing studies on whether there are more cost-effective and more effective and more resilient backup power recovery methodologies, and we're looking at that right now.
I just wanted to add to that, Miranda.
Yeah, I would just add to that, you know, the way we think about it is we think of at least three and perhaps four overlapping circles. If you imagine a Venn diagram, since we don't have slides, you can just have to use your imaginations, where you've got resiliency, the ability to quickly get back up and running in the face of an unexpected disruption. You've got cheap, how affordable is your power, and then you've got clean. And you could add a fourth one called efficient. Right? And the sweet spot is right smack in the middle. And that's what we're talking about with these microgrid demonstrations. I really think we're beyond the small pilot phase. We've done a number of very successful pilots at the nano level and at the installation level. And each of our the three services are taking those pilots to the next phase. So that sweet spot's right in the middle, where you have high resiliency, affordable when you're not down, when the grid's not down, it's affordable, right? So I think this idea of how much should we pay for energy security? Yeah, we should be talking about that, but we should also be talking about how much can we save building resilient grid-of-grid types of nationwide infrastructure on a day-to-day basis, right? I think we have to flip. Now, I'm from Walmart, so we tend to think about things about how much you can save rather than how much you can spend, so you'll have to forgive me, but... yeah, I think we need to flip that equation on its head a little bit. And then clean. You know, in an ideal world, you'd have all those, and that would be your sweet spot. You're not always going to get that, right? Sometimes to get the resiliency you need, it may not be cleaner or cheaper. You know, and I think it's a myth that the Department of Defense doesn't pay extra for energy security. Well, sure we do. Sure we do. Every one of those generators, all of the diesel, all of the maintenance, all of the testing... Sure, we're paying for energy security today on our installations, unquestionably. In the Air Force, on the operational energy side, this may not be news to everyone in the room, but it may be news to some folks. When you think about resiliency from an aircraft perspective, you want that aircraft to be able to fuel up on whatever type of fuel is available wherever it happens to land in the world. So something that was done a couple of predecessors ago in the Air Force for operational energy resiliency is all of our aircraft are certified to fly in a range of different types of fuels, not just Jet A and JP-8, but also synthetic fuels and various bioblends and the like, because we want to be able to be resilient in the face of whatever jet fuel is available to us.
Oh, that's great. And we are fortunate enough today to have the former Assistant Secretary of Defense for Homeland Defense and Western Hemisphere Affairs, which no longer exists, but in that form, but the issues are still very important in the department. This is Paul Stockton, Dr. Paul Stockton. Do you have any follow-up to that? I'm just curious. I'm totally putting you on the spot. And by the way, all of you whom I know in the audience are totally fair game. So I can see him right there. So, I mean, I'm just curious if you have a follow-up on that.
I do have a follow-up question, and it's to anybody who'd like to answer. I love the way you're driving change and building resilience. One of the things that I didn't recognize when I was in office is the extraordinary dependence of installations and mission assurance on water and wastewater services. Without wastewater, the Pentagon becomes a nasty place very, very quickly. Might already be nasty, but
no.
It gets much worse. As you think about these holistic approaches to energy resilience, and think about loads outside the base that may be critical for mission assurance, to what extent are you beginning to incorporate emergency power for water and wastewater systems outside your perimeters, many of which lack adequate emergency power?
So outside the fence line. Richard?
So I'll take that. So again, the strategy document doesn't say energy security. It also has the word sustainability, which is a recognition of the connection between water and energy and water and land and all of those systems that collectively allow our bases to be resilient. So we have a growing awareness of that. And in terms of water supply outside of our installations and relationships with the local communities, all the services have a long established set of practices where we interact with the local communities on a variety of issues, land use, pollution, water, et cetera. And this just has to be another item in that dialogue that we have with our local community. And it's not just here in the United States, it's also overseas. So we had cases in Afghanistan where we drew a shallow well, lowered the aquifer, and the village community well went dry. We weren't successful in our counterinsurgency mission when we deprived the local inhabitants of water. So we have to include this water aspect in all that we do, both operationally and domestically. If I could, just two other quick points. If the Eastern grid went down now, you would have the lights on at Fort Drum, New York, where we have a biomass plant, a new substation, and a direct feed. It's not a cyber secure microgrid, but it is a standalone island capability for 30 days of energy at Fort Drum and the surrounding community. Also, this issue of microgrids, though, to go back to Mr. Conger's point and Secretary McGinn's, we have a lot of third-party finance options out there, and I've been working hard for years. I have not figured out a way to use third-party finance to pay for a microgrid, all right? We do know how to do them. We have the engineering specs. We're all ready and willing to get a bigger microgrid out there, installation-wide or wider. But in the current budget climate, there's no MILCON, and there's no infrastructure MILCON in particular. So that is a challenge.
Just curious, with Fort Drum, what's the justification? Because, I mean, or have you been able to price resilience in that instance, the fact that you've got 30 days of backup? Is there some?
So that was a condition in our negotiations with the partner. So there was a coal plant that was converted to biomass, and we basically used the authorities of the department to go up to a 30-year contract. So we were able to leverage that renewable energy baseload at or below current and projected future costs. We'll have to watch that closely because the grid costs are tied to natural gas, but we justified it because of this level of energy security. And as long as we were not going over the projections, we were comfortable signing the agreement.
I'd like to open it up to the audience, and we'll give Denny a chance to add to that. And then I'll have one last shot at y'all before the audience gets theirs. And I want to turn to the future on climate change. So I can tee you up to answer your question, and then we'll...
Really
quickly on resiliency. Whole system thinking is really, really important. If you go back to the tragedy of the tsunami, Fukushima Daiichi, the backup power system, had it continued to function, would have saved a tremendous amount of agony and cost and across the board because of the nuclear meltdown. So when we are thinking in the department about resiliency, it's one thing to have a nice, brand new, shiny diesel generator set that's low emissions and efficient and all that good stuff. But you really have to think, is it going to work when the flood is coming, when the wind is blowing, when things are really, really bad? Where is not just the diesel generator set, where's the fuel supply? Where is the transformer? Where is the switch mechanism? How do you make that work in a whole systems way? That is really, really key. When we think about climate change and increased intensity and frequency of storms, for example, or wildfires in the West, using that systems thinking is really, really critical. We want to make sure that we are thinking in terms of how it will be when you need it the most, not how it's going to be on a nice, bright, sunny day when the birds are singing and everybody's right in the middle of the so-called regular work day. And that really, really does make a difference when you think through the whole system and how you can do things better. A set of rules that John and others in the services have been working on for construction standards, for example. My first rule is, if you're in a FEMA floodplain, don't put the servers in the basement of the building. That's a bad thing to do. And you can apply the same thing to the emergency backup power.
John, you want to pick up on that as far as climate change, the adaptation roadmap, and the sort of practical steps that Denny just outlined, some of the things that you're actually doing?
Well, Denny stole my line about the servers in the basement, but that's okay.
You can say it again.
So the policy that we put out, I want to say a year or two ago, basically said to minimize your MILCON in the floodplains. And if you are going, doesn't say you can't, because frankly, most of the Navy's bases are in floodplains. But the yeah.
Makes it easier to get the ship off.
But the fact
off,
of the matter
right?
is you have to certify that you've taken these risks into account and mitigated the risks. It's not very complicated. Once again, there's a lot of risk you can mitigate if you acknowledge the risk exists. And so what we've done is we've incorporated climate change into a whole host of policy documents in the department, whether it be master planning on our bases or power resilience or water policy. You have to think through the impacts of the climate change. You know, this is probably most of these impacts are years away, right? So we have time to think these things through. Some impacts are closer in time, but a lot of them we're talking about. Sea levels rise by a foot over the next 30 years or more. So, all right, don't put your building there if you can help it, for example. But the climate change adaptation roadmap, which we put out last fall, was a fairly significant document in the context that it laid out. We want to be thinking through these things and incorporating this thought process into the policies of the department, forcing people, creating the inertia, and putting it in those documents and all of the processes that people follow. You have to take this risk into account. And maybe you don't have to do anything about it, this building or that building. But the fact of the matter is that we have to take that and bake it into the calculus.
Because I think a lot of folks were worried that there was going to be a big price tag. But it sounds like what you're saying is not necessarily.
So we put out this policy last fall, and the first question I got from my friends on the Hill, some of whom are in the room, was, well, where's the line for this in the budget? And there isn't a line for it in the budget. If I'm going to build a new building, that building has its own line. The fact of the matter is that it's how you do what you do, not what you do, that's going to be affected by this.
And I think there's a lot more there, but I didn't want to give the audience a chance to ask questions because there are other things to ask about how you do what you do. For example, how you plan for the future, how you require new systems for the future, and is the department incorporating energy security and climate change or resilience and climate change into that whole planning process? And would would say from my point of view, probably not as much as it could be yet. But I'll lay that out there. You may pick it up if you wish or not. But at this point, I would like to give the audience a chance to. Let's go to Dorothy Robine, who did such a fantastic job for the department and also at GSA afterwards as a leader in this space.
Two questions. The first one for Richard. In speaking of GSA, they have a terrific microgrid at White Oak, former naval facility. It's now the FDA headquarters. It's a natural gas turbine-fired microgrid that was done entirely through it's a Honeywell ESPC. It was done entirely through an ESPC. So why can you not do that? And then here's my second question for any of you. This has been a great discussion, but I want to point out it has been almost entirely about on the supply side, renewable energy and how distributed energy makes things more secure. There's been almost no discussion of energy efficiency and how you reduce demand. So I would love to hear about, I know there's impediments, but how are you doing and what are those impediments?
Richard?
So Dorothy, great to see you. Thanks for the question. So I'm familiar with the White Oak facility. I took the entire Army team and our installation management counterparts up for professional development day to tour that facility to sort of open the apertures to the eyes of the possible. We have similar type microgrids built through ESPCs at the campus level, but not at the installation level. When you start to put in all of the distribution lines across the installation, connecting the generators, it can't be paid for through energy savings, which is the statutory requirement for ESPCs. So either we have to bundle appropriated funds with an ESPC, we have to change the statute so that we can collect revenue from grid services that a microgrid can provide to a utility partner, or we're just going to have to go out and build it ourselves with Milcon to get that at Fort Bragg. So we have half a dozen campus-level microgrids with thermal storage and boilers, combined heat power, other things at Fort Bragg, but we can't connect the whole base. So it's an issue of scale and economics of where you are in the price of your power.
Quite strong now. Are they making that a change in that legislation part of what they're lobbying?
I can't vouch for what they're lobbying. I've heard rumors that they have gotten some papers that write this up in great detail, and what they've done with it, you'll have to ask them.
I got secret code from someone in the audience who writes legislation in this area that no, they're not getting. Hearing much about it, so maybe it's time.
That's too bad, because they got relief from scoring. Sure. I mean, they were successful enough to get directed scoring.
But if they had to change the legislation, I would question whether CBO would give them a pass.
Yeah. And just quickly on climate change, so again, don't want to draw too much of an exception to Mr. Conger about how things may be in the future. Right now, this year, the Army has never had as much training disrupted by weather-related events in our entire history. And we have unique events at installations and unique combination events across installations. We have droughts in areas where we've never had droughts and we can't fly helicopters because of brownouts. We have firing ranges built on permafrost that have sunk into the ground. We have had range towers at Fort Irwin that have washed away in a flood of unprecedented magnitude. We have ranges where we cannot shoot due to drought. All right, we can't shoot things that explode and burn because of the drought in the West. So I'll be presenting a slide to the Army senior leadership in a number of weeks that says, sir, gentlemen, ladies, you're experiencing climate change right now. It's degrading the readiness of our forces because we cannot train the way we want to train.
It's too bad that's
Yeah,
I was going to say, are you going to be able to share those numbers and the specifics of that publicly? Once you present it to the general officers. Because it's too bad we're before that, because it would be fascinating to hear what the reaction is to that. Miranda, it doesn't have to be you, but I'm just picking up on the one other question that Dorothy asked about demand. Because, you know, she has a good point, not just on the installations, but certainly in the operational environment, it does matter how much fuel you're putting in the battle space. it is a target, it is a vulnerability, particularly in the era of precision-guided munitions. So what about the demand side of the equation?
Can I pile on the climate change thing just
please.
Very briefly?
Please.
So while I don't have quite as many examples as Mr. Kidd just took us through with the Army, the Air Force is seeing similar kinds of events. If you look up in Alaska, we have a number of radar sites right along the coast that we're seeing enormous coastal erosion because of the melting of the sea ice up there. So for most of history, certainly the history of these radar sites, you've had protective sea ice to take the waves, essentially. And with that ice gone, you're just seeing massive erosion. And we're mapping out that in a very short period of time, we're going to start seeing radars falling into the sea, and we don't want that to happen.
Right, when things are heating up there, so to speak, in other ways.
Heating up there. In addition, in the Air Force 30-year strategic plan, one of the key five global threats that we're looking at is increasing competition for the global commons. And we often talk about the South China Sea as the global commons that we want to protect for sea trade lanes and economic flows. And with the melting of the Arctic sea ice, we suddenly have a new global commons that we're looking at and thinking about. And I'll leave that to Secretary McGinn to talk about further if he would like. There are a number of ways that we need to be thinking about the impacts of climate change to our operations, to geopolitical risks, to mission risks, to financial risks, the whole gamut, beyond just are we going to have water and what happens with the floodplain maps. So efficiency. Efficiency both of installations as well as operations, absolutely critical. It's should be sort of the number one, number two, number three thing you do. You don't want to put renewable energy on an inefficient base. So there are a couple of challenges. One, the shrinking FSRM budgets and shrinking MILCON budgets that John sort of grounded us in the beginning are a real challenge because there are a number of just basic building infrastructure sustainment and recapitalization issues that you can't build into ESPCs because they're not energy savings projects. But when you have leaking roofs and leaking walls and old windows and things like that, some of which can go into ESPCs, some of which can't, when you just have buildings that are old, they are inefficient. So there's some real problems with energy efficiency. That said, I think all three services have a pretty good track record. At the Air Force, we've had about a 22-23% absolute energy reduction and energy intensity reduction in facilities. Now, on the operational side, primarily mobility, right? So John was talking about mobility before. In our combat air forces, what you're going to see when you see increased efficiency is it's going to go to increased capability, increased combat capability. But when you're talking about mobility, you've got your certain mobility missions. And if you can accomplish those missions with less fuel, you're going to accomplish those missions with less fuel. And across the Air Force, we've seen about a $2.5 billion, I won't say savings, but cost avoided thanks to various energy initiatives, primarily in operational energy. I would encourage you, if you like YouTube, I just actually held a panel with a number of folks from a captain level up to a colonel level and a PhD at AFRL who walked us through a whole host of things that we're doing, from training our pilots, from very basic pilot training to think about energy efficiency and ascend and descend differently, changing our refueling tracts for our tanker and refueling training so that we're using literally tens of millions of dollars less of fuel in our training. To how we load cargo in our cargo airplanes to be more efficient. So those are kind of
some examples. More efficient engines and even possibly body shapes down the line.
In the non-boring side, the really fun technical stuff, next generation engines and rethinking how aircraft should be designed, that kind of stuff.
That's good. I think we had a question over here. Yes? And if you would please identify yourself.
I'm Robert Edson. I represent Veolia today. I also work half-time with Booz Allen and I support all three of your programs. I think all of you have made really good advances in supply side, particularly on the renewables. And I think the demand side is always ongoing, so it's going to be continuous. But I think you're at a real crossing the roads right now, a real challenge. With MILCON diminished, and your desire to be more resilient, things like microgrids, how do you pay for that? They're all very expensive, and as Richard says, you can't really do it on a installation-wide basis with third-party financing. But I'd like to throw something out that I think I'd like to qualify a few things, but there is an authority that you have, which is utility privatization, which today is looked upon as kind of an onerous program because it takes 2 years to get through some of the solicitations. But there are a lot of good infrastructure companies out there that do water, wastewater, electricity. And I think if you were to effect, Mr. Conger, some policy changes in the statute that would enable flexibility in how it's used, so that it can be used not just to operate and maintain existing infrastructure.
I'm sorry for interrupting you, but we're over time already.
I'm
so
there.
Okay.
But to actually do some additional generation and microgrids, which can be paid for over a long term, because that's a 50-year statute. I'd like to get your thoughts on that.
So my general thought on enacting changes to the to statute is that you run into the challenge of CBO scoring things like crazy. I've run into that once or twice or more times. And so what you end up with is this, it's going to cost something, so you need an offset, and you're not going to find an offset, so you're not going to be able to pass the law that changes the statute. CBO is particularly pays particular scrutiny to anything which will seem like borrowing money. And so what you have to fall back on is the statutes that we currently have need to be the ones that we use to do the creative things. And without going to get... I'm happy to look at things along those lines, but I think the trick here is, and then going back to circuiting back to Dorothy's point to wrap everything up on a downer, is there is no money. We are being penny wise pound foolish because we have no pennies, and as long as we have the BCA and as long as we have sequestration, we're not going to see the performance that we want to see on the demand side, because we're not going to have money to invest in old buildings. We're not going to be able to recapitalize. We just can't do it. We are looking at what are the no-cost, low-cost types of things that we can do in the department to try and change behavior and change the efficiency patterns of certain buildings. But that's not going to get us to where we want to go. We are in a monetarily constrained environment. And that's a fact of life right now, and that does put a damper on a lot of things.
So I'm not going to let it end on a sad note. What I'm thinking I'm going to say is that we are going to have a reception. I think Phyllis is going to talk about it in a second. So I know not that many people got to ask questions, but please bring your question to the reception. So just the last thing, and we'll start with Denny. You've got about a year left, a little more than a year, right? What do you want to get done in the time you have left? And let's see if we can end that on a positive note.
I'd like to continue to blow past 1 gigawatt for shore installations. I want to have our ships with inherent new ships and retrofitted with things like stern flaps. We are, by the way, relighting all of our ships with LED lighting. Tremendous advantages there. I want to make sure that our Marines in the deployment of their expeditionary energy are really, really well equipped along the lines that Richard's example showed. We want to electrify as much ashore in terms of converting from diesel and gasoline powered things, vehicles, forklifts, bucket trucks, to electric, where that electric is cleaner and cheaper. And we're doing that. So there's a whole bunch of things. And I am optimistic. Despite the woes about money, and they are real, there's a lot of good things that are going on. And thank goodness for third-party financing. We just need to be as creative as we can, public and private, in how we can use those authorities to really make a difference on energy efficiency as well as new generating sources.
Richard?
So I've been there 5 years, and I'm a career SES, so I'm not going anywhere that I know of.
He's got more time.
But I work alongside political appointees. I've done it from both administrations, and I know that administrations change. So if I have a goal is to do that boring stuff that Ms. Ballantyne mentioned consistently and deliberately in a thoughtful manner to embed energy security, sustainability, resiliency into all the foundational documents of the Army by the time the administration changes, so that inertia and momentum is at least headed in the right direction.
And we are lucky to have people like Richard who are in the career ranks who do carry on. It's a great secret of the department.
I would love to be confirmed as the department's deputy comptroller and solve the sequestration.
Okay, that's a good answer. All right.
Well, I too am optimistic by nature. I can't help it. And there are so many, many tools at our disposal to help overcome the very real fiscal challenges we've got. And, you know, I honestly couldn't have said the boring stuff better than Richard did. So whatever he said, just put the quotes and add my name to the end. I think I'm senior between the two of us, so maybe I can claim that it's mine. But in all sincerity, it for me, it really is about embedding in the organizational foundational documents. Our 30-year strategic plan is written, too late for that, although energy is already in it. Our 20-year strategic master planning document and all the flight plans that go below it, and then creating the organizational infrastructures to support commitment to this work on an ongoing basis.
I think that's great. I don't think that's boring at all, actually. I mean, what you're talking about is what it actually takes to make change, and that it's not that easy, and it does take hard work. And I think it's very encouraging to hear that you're all thinking that way. And by the way, I do have a confession to make. It wasn't Pew that said no PowerPoint. That was me. But my understanding was that's the guidance from the Secretary of Defense. So I thought that would be comfortable for all of you, and certainly for all of you. So let me turn it over to Phyllis at this point, and she'll give some last words and thank the speakers.
Well, this has been a great panel. I want to thank all of our panelists, Sharon and Senator Warner, of course. I'm going to be very brief, which is just to welcome you downstairs, and our staff can direct you. You just walk right down these stairs or take one elevator, the elevator one floor down, and please join us for wine or beer or a libation of any sort and something to eat and further conversation. So thanks to all of you for coming, and again, thanks to all of you for participating.